Yesterday I spoke to you in response to the question, how to move from attachment to non-attachment. What is very important, whatever we do in our lives on a day-to-day basis, we have to be into it totally. The moment you are into it totally, you are walking. Totally means mindful. You are not doing anything else. Then automatically you will attain to the state of non-attachment. Someone asked Buddha, what is your religion? What do you do? Buddha said, I eat when I eat. I sleep when I sleep. I walk when I walk. The man replied, this is what we all do. Buddha said, how many of us are aware of it? Most of our actions are unconscious. We are closing the door, but we are not available to that moment. We may be thinking of something else. We are eating food, but we are not available to that moment. We are not totally into it. We are not mindful of our actions. Then questions like this, how can one be in a committed relationship and yet be non-attached, comes. These questions are the outcome of unconscious living, being unmindful of anything that we do. We live by our physical minds, the instincts. Naturally, your car steering moves automatically towards your house. You may be thinking of something else. The physical mind is trained mechanically to work in a certain way. But unless and until your entire being into that act, you are not satiated. When you are not satiated, then you will be continuously striving to attain to something that is your birthright. And then naturally the questions like this, how can one be in a committed relationship and yet non-attached, will arise. This I had spoken. Today I will speak on the cycles of sex energy. Man is an integrated being, that is how he is born. But he is not allowed to live his life naturally as it should be. Many things are imposed on him from the outer world. These relate to the conditionings and things like these. Remember, human life is synthesis. It is the harmony of opposites. It comes as totally pure and sanctified. Just like hail storms that shower during the winter season. However, because of Earth's atmosphere and its impurities, these get polluted. So too, sex is not only the essential core of energy, but it is natural and spontaneous. It is one form of existential bioenergy, but it gets defiled by the baser minds. The cycles go in 7 years period. If human life is to be divided into 7 years cycles. The first cycle is of 7 years from 0 to 7. During that cycle of life, of biological life. Remember, biology and psychology are interconnected to one another. They cannot be separated in any way. The biology affects the psychology and psychology affects the biological movements of the person, of the child. Remember, whenever we are doing and we are taking anything like alcohol and so, it affects our body naturally. And when there is an affliction in the body, pain or something in the body, it affects us mentally. We cannot separate the body and the mind naturally. It has to be done consciously. This happens when the meditation deepens. Then there comes a gap between the body, mind and spirit. You are living in the body, but the pains of the body are not there because consciousness is at a different level. This is what had happened with Ramakrishna. Ramakrishna was suffering from throat cancer. He had a liking for a particular food or dish, and any time the meditation sessions was going on, Ramakrishna will run to the kitchen and ask Sharda, what did you cook? Sharda, not only she but the others, Sharda was more concerned because the disciples used to feel embarrassed that the master has not completely detached himself from the food. That the master has not completely detached from the foods, the meditation session is going on, and he runs to the kitchen like an innocent child to know what is cooked, what is going to be served for lunch today. One day Sharda said, Ramakrishna Dev, you run to the kitchen to find out about the food, your disciples feel embarrassed. Then Ramakrishna responded to Sharda, said, Sharda, there is nothing that binds me into this life. As far as I am concerned, there is nothing for me to gain. Remember that oft-used important sutra from chapter 3 of Bhagavad Gita, Name Parthastu Krishlokeshu Kinchana. Yogeshwar tells Arjun that I have nothing to do in the three universes, nothing to gain. Because having attained to enlightenment, there isn't anything else to be done. The fruition has happened, for which lives after lives I have been waiting has happened. There isn't anything more than that to come. Now I have to live with that awareness. But my work is not over. My work is not over for which I have come. I have come here. Ramakrishna Paramahansa had come into the world in preparation for the next millennium. Just as Hazrat Baqiullah Razillah Talavna was sent to prepare for the next millennium, and he waited for the advent of Hazrat Sheikh Ahmed Farooqi Mujaddid Alif Sani Razillah Talavna. He was sent because Sheikh Ahmed Mujaddidi Alif Sani Raziullah Ta'ala Uno was destined to be born in India. And one of the hadith says that Holy Prophet said that after there will be 17 Ahmads, and the 17th will be very powerful, and that will be the beginning of the second millennium. And it was after 1000 years of the advent of Holy Prophet Hazrat Paigambar Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that Sheikh Ahmed Farooqi Mujaddid Alif Sani Raziullah Ta'ala Uno was born in Sarhind Sharif, in a state of Punjab. And before that, the ground has to be prepared. Hazrat Amkan Ki Raziullah Ta'ala Uno told his Khalifa, the chief disciple, Hazrat Baqiullah Raziullah Ta'ala Uno, who was in trade business and trading, and he said, I am sending you to a faraway land, the land of Buddhas, whose very soil is ready for the advent of new consciousness. and that was in preparation for the advent of the second millennium in Nakshbandi system. Ramakrishna said that my work is not over. He was to begin the second in preparation for the advent of Vivekananda, because with Vivekananda many avenues were opened. That was one of his greatest contributions. And he said, as far as I am concerned, I am free to sail to the other shore any moment. But then, because my work is not finished, I have to create an anchor so that I can remain on this shore for a little longer until my work is over. Sharda thought it to be another excuse from Ramakrishna for his insatiable quest for food. Ramakrishna told her that time that the day I turn my face from the food, 3 days after I have been over. The day I turn my face from the food, 3 days after I have been over. This happened, it was said many years before. Thereafter Vivekananda came, the work continued, and Vivekananda was prepared, nourished and nurtured his consciousness. He was ready to plunder into the world for which he had been sent. Ramakrishna was suffering from throat cancer, and all the days he could not eat anything. Then one day Vivekananda asked, he said, you should talk to the mother and ask her to relieve your pain, because when we see your pain, it is unbearable to us. Ramakrishna closed his eyes for a few moments and then responded. He said, I spoke to the mother, and mother said, you have used your body for too long. Now live with other bodies. I live through your bodies. When you eat, I get nourished. This was the state that he was completely detached from the physical being. The pain of the physical being was not in causing any pain to his consciousness and affecting his consciousness. The similar was case with Raman. He was also suffering from a similar cancer disease, cancer ailments. These things are there simply to show to us that one can live totally a non-attached life. He was totally non-attached to his physical being and its consciousness of the physical. One day it happened, Ramakrishna was lying on the bed. Sharda cooked the food that Ramakrishna liked, and she came with the platter in her hand. Ramakrishna, babe, look, I brought the food for you, the same food that you like very much. Ramakrishna turned her face towards her, looked into her eyes as if to remind her, Sharda, do you remember my words when I said, the day I turn my face from the food, 3 days after I'll be no more. A silent communion happened between Sharda and Ramakrishna Dev. Ramakrishna Dev looked at Sharda and looked at the platter and then turned his towards the other side. Immediately the plate slipped, the platter slipped from the hands of Sharda. She remembered the words of the Master, the words of the enlightened, and 3 days after Ramakrishna was no more. This is state of total non-attachment, being in a state of attachment. These things go together. There is no way that you can leave the world. Wherever you go, to the mountains, to the peaks, or wherever you go, the world is, world surrounds you. You can be in the world, but the world will not be in you. This is the way of the meditators. This is the way of sannyasins. This is the way of seekers. First cycle is the physical. The first cycle is from 0 to 7 years of age. During that child, the child is unaware of sex, sex instincts. It is known as the state of zero sex. And that time, each child tries to explore his genitals, tries to explore his sexuality, the sex instincts. And what happens, the child plays with his genitals. But as a parents, we have not lived our life naturally. So we do not allow anyone else to live their life naturally. Every child engages in the activities like that because he's getting the sensations within his body and there is no one to explain that to him. So him or her engages in activities like masturbations, and that is natural. If that is curtailed, then you are hampering the growth of the consciousness of the child. This is natural. This should be the part of the education. But every child does it, and every parent stops the child from doing that. The children have learned the habit from the very beginning to hide and do things like that. And this continues lifelong. But this is natural. 0 to 7. If the child lives that totally, naturally it happens automatically it slips out of your life. If you have done something consciously, not hiding, not doing it unknowingly, not doing it unconsciously, then it automatically slips out of your hand and your growth will be of a totally different nature. The second cycle is that of next 7 years, starting from 7 to 14. This is known as the first cycle, 0-6, the second is known as auto-6. During that child, the boys are friendly with the boys, the girls are friendly with the girls, and they do not intermingle with one another. If you tell a boy of that age that your girlfriend is coming, he gets angry. He says, I have no girlfriend, I don't like girls, I like boys. Similar is the case with the girls. They mix with their own clan because there is something similar among themselves. And if this is lived properly, then the further growth of the plant, of the tree, of the bud will not be dwarfed, the flower will not be dwarfed, instead it will attain to its full bloom. But what happens that every child, when it grows up, his consciousness is hampered and he becomes a dwarf. No human being has attained to its totality as it's supposed to be. That is, the Buddhahood is the ultimate flowering of each individual. This happens naturally. Thereafter, the next third cycle comes in, where this is known as hetero cycle. During this cycle of 7 years, from 14 to 21, the boys are interested in girls, the girls are interested in boys. There is a tremendous attraction for the opposite sex. This attraction is at the level of psychology. But when it is hampered, it becomes the attraction for the physical. Both goes together. But if we are trained, we are understood, we understand the psychology of the sex instincts, we will be able to outgrow that and go beyond that, and our growth will be natural. But it does not happen in that way. Our growth remains hampered and there is no continuation of that. Then 21 to 28, 28 to 35, these are the peak age stages, peak cycles, when the energy is at its peak. And it is during that time that one should engage in the activities, not of procreation, but of exploring, understanding one another, and then going beyond the sex. Remember, it is through the interaction of ovum and sperm that you were born one day. When your father and mother interacted, the ovum and sperm interacted with one another. As a consequence, the body was formed. And with that, the psychology, the psyche also came into existence. So too, when two individuals, male and female, engaged in the physical act or understand it properly, then one day, it is in that moment of physical union between male and female, one can attain to transcendence. And that is the very essence of this, the male-female relation, the very essence of the sexual life, that one is born one day through the interaction between ovum and sperm, And one day, through that mechanism alone, with awareness in a state of meditativeness, when one engages in the act meditatively, with total awareness, that one day one attains to the state of transcendence. And that is the very purpose of giving you the male-female relationship, bringing the Adam and Eve's concept, the male-female concept. This is anima and animus. It is in that state, the inner, there is a union between inner woman and inner man. As such, there is no experience of the inner man or inner woman. The man experiences, man is outer, the woman is outer. It is only the outer man and the outer woman merged with one another. Master Luzu says in that the secret of the golden life is comes into existence only when the inner man and inner woman is experienced. It is in a state of meditativeness when a seeker continues his life that there is an experience of the inner woman and inner man. And the satiation never comes unless and until your inner man and inner woman is united. And when the inner man and the inner woman is united, there is satiation at the level of the sex. One attains the state beyond the sex. Then the outer union between the male and female becomes insignificant. It may be there, it may not be there. And one attains to the state of total non-attachment with them. And this is what it happened, that many people, the masters, have attained to that state. Tantra emphasizes on that, uses the techniques of meditation in order to go beyond that state of the physical dependence. Then having merged the anima and animus, the masculine energy and the feminine energy that is within you, that has come with the interaction between ovum and sperm within you, that is the representative of the anima and animus, the male element and the female element, the yin and yang, the Shiva and Shakti according to the Hindu way of life. When the Shiva and Shakti merge, that is the way of the attaining to the Ardhanarishwar. You are neither male nor female. This is the state of Buddha. When you look at the Buddha, he is neither masculine nor feminine. Instead, he has the two instincts within him. He is masculine at the same time feminine. This is the concept that is shown with the image of Shiva. Half of his body is male and half of his body is female. That is Ardhanarishwar, neither male nor female. This does not mean that you have become a eunuch, that you have become the beyond. This is a state of beyondness, not a deformity. This is a state of beyondness that they both. You can understand the anima and animus have merged into one another. You can understand the male instincts as well as the female instincts. And that is the state of enlightenment, that is the state of mastery. That is the ultimate destiny of each and every individual. And by the time one attains to the age of 42, the seventh cycle, the sixth cycle of seven years, one should be totally. One should have totally attained to this state of merger of anima and animus within. The male within and the female within are merged into one another. One has attained to the satiation through the physical sex, and thereafter the life continues. That is the life of beyondness. And it is for that reason Carl Gustav Jung, the Swedish psychologist, have said, out of my 40 years of medical practice, I have come to this conclusion. If by the time one attains to the age of 40, if religion is given to him, the humanity, the man can be saved. And he is right. By the time 42, one attains to the age of 42, one should be totally free from the physical attachment for one another. That does not mean that after that there will be no physical relationship between male and female. But what is the difference between one who is involving out of his lust and one who is involving into that act? That is the ultimate in sex. There is no sexuality, There is something, this state of beyondness, this is Neptune. And there you experience a totally different kind of way. You attain to samadhi. Sex becomes samadhi. Sex becomes transcendent. You will be in the world, but the world will not be in you. You can experience the higher realms of you, but it does not happen that way because we do not allow the natural growth of the child. From the very beginning, we have not allowed the natural growth. Then it happens many ugly things, sexuality, the perversions, many things that has become the order of the day. And then it happens that the man is unsatiated, the woman has become exposed. And because of that exposition, the interest is lost into it, and the interest has become more into pornography. Interest has become more in the perversions of it, and man is interested in it. A totally naked person does not create any ripples in you. That is the reason that the women remain covered, and that creates a quest in an individual to explore the hidden mysteries. The hidden mysteries, once the mysteries are exposed to an individual, the interest is lost, the perversion begins. And thereafter, the energy begins to move downward instead of it's moving upward. Because you remember, you have not reached the hilltop properly in a regular way. Maybe somebody had brought you onto the hilltop, so you do not know what it takes to reach to the hilltop, that is the 42 years of age. And after that, descent begins. You do not have to make any effort, and just automatically life moves on in harmony, without any efforts, effortlessly. This is the life of the beyond peace, beyond enlightenment. And then it is a blissfulness, a life of bliss and harmony and oneness. But in the absence, distortions, ugly exchange of words, and many things happen. Because the energy has not been explored within, the time has lapsed, there is no more physical energy left in that in order to be transformed. Because you remember, you have to have the water in the pot for the steam to be formed. The water in the pot is finished, or the fire underneath is finished, so how can there be steam? It requires a physical energy, and man is at the peak of his physical energy at during that cycle of his biological cycle of 21 to 35 years of age. That is the highest peak of the physical energy. And that is wasted in the ugly pursuits of many things. And because of the upbringing of the churches and the conflict that has been created by the outer religion, that man is not allowed to live his natural life, that opportunity is lost. Then the energy is lost. He has nothing. There is no water in the pot, no fire underneath. The steam cannot be there, and it cannot transcend beyond the finite boundaries. Then the divorce is there, the separation is there, and in that case, the best friend of every female is a female one who has similar problems in her life, and such is the case with the divorce. The every female's best friend after the age of 42 is another female who has been facing similar problems in her life, with her husband, with her love, with her married life, or things like that. And every male tries to associate with the person who has similar problems in his life, and the life continues like that, distorted. These are the six cycles I spoke, and these are the most relevant cycles, because you have to reach to the hilltop and then start the descent. and that is thereafter whatever life continues, it is the outcome of this understanding or lack of understanding. If there had been an understanding while there is awakening, there is mindfulness, there is meditativeness, there is understanding of the religion and the inner functioning of the energy, then while you are reaching to the hilltop, you have utilized every single iota of your energy. To reach to the hilltop, then the descent becomes natural and spontaneous. The life will be a blissful harmony. Otherwise, whatever is happening is the outcome. Only this much on these cycles of 7 year cycles of human life. I will continue in the series.